Okay, today we're going to talk about pressure and what is atmospheric pressure. We want to start with some real basics here. For example, you know, what are air molecules? Now, how do we know there's pressure? Well, all of us have done this. We probably stuck our hand out the car, rolled down the window, or cruising down the freeway, and all of a sudden our hand starts going up and down, just like an airplane, right? So that's one way we know. Another way is we have something called a barometer. But before we do that, let me show you. Here's a great diagram. It shows all these different air molecules. Notice it is denser closer to the Earth. Now, why is that? Well, number one, the Earth has a gravitational force. It's going to pull air down toward the surface or sea level. Secondly, there is the cumulative mass. There is the weight of the atmosphere. The nitrogen molecules and oxygen molecules, they add up to weight, and we call that pressure. And that's really all it is, by the way. Denser and less dense. Now, we're going to refer to these as different terms, low pressure and high pressure. And what we're talking about is not the elevation here or the altitude. We're talking about the intensity of these air molecules. Okay? And so you can see near the Earth here, it's more intense. So is that going to be higher or lower? It's higher pressure, right? Is it going to be lower pressure as you go up in altitude? Now, let me put a barometer. Okay, a few hundred years ago, Curious Chat was, I won't mention the name here, was had created what we call a primitive, at the time a primitive barometer. Today we still have mercurial barometers. Here he has a mercury in a dish, and he has sucked out the air in this tube. And lo and behold, when he put that tube in the mercury dish, it went up to about 30 inches. And this stuff's pretty heavy. And yet it went all the way up. Today our standard air pressure is 29.92. I'm going to show you another barometer and then talk about an altimeter. But to this day, the altimeter in aircraft still refers to inches at 29.92. Now, there's not a lot of variation. You know, super duper low pressure might be in the 28s, super duper high 31s. Super duper low is a typhoon or a hurricane. And a super high pressure might be like in the Arctic or something where there's just really dense sinking air. But mostly it doesn't move that much. We still use that in aircraft. Whether people would use more millibars. So in this case here, 1,013.2 is our average standard temperature, standard elevation, like sea level. Okay? But the main thing to realize is the air pressure does change from hour to hour. It changes from day to day, and it changes from place to place. There's another kind of barometer that's very common. Okay, it's called an aneroid barometer. It's a cylinder of air that with a little diaphragm here, and that can shrink and compress, shrink, slash, expand with different air pressure. It also can keep track of, you know, the hourly changes right here. So behind this glass cabinet here, we can see a mercurial barometer. It is quite tall, over 30 inches tall. And if we were to zoom in there, we would see that it would change. We could actually read the changes every day, let's say, on the mercury going up and down. Okay, and then moving on over to here, we can see an aneroid barometer, and it's actually recording the hourly changes daily. Okay, so I wanted to show you another diagram here of air molecules, and we have them in a cylinder here that's volume is 1 cubic meter here and volume of 2 cubic meters. And the idea is that, you know, pressure is just simply relative to one another. So if we were to take this cylinder with 2 cubic meters and compress it to 1 cubic meter, we've taken in effect all these air molecules and we have increased the air pressure. There are consequences with that. We'll talk about that later. Okay, so this would be higher pressure, or high pressure if you want to just abbreviate it. And then over here on this side, this would be low pressure. Okay, and as we expand this, there are also effects. I might as well tell you right now, if you were to continue to do this, take all these molecules and shrink them in half, you would be compressing it. That will then excite the molecules it will then start to heat up the air inside of here, and it will dry out the air. This would be associated with high pressure and sinking air that we see in the atmosphere. Over here, if you have air that's forced up and is expanded, especially quickly, you'll actually see, you can do an experiment like in fourth grade where you see, you know, you pull it apart really quickly and you'll actually see a cloud form. Let me just show you that real quick. Okay, so like I have canned air, it's just air that was compressed in here earlier at the factory. And, you know, I turn it upside down, you know, we can get a cloud right here. I don't know if you guys can see that. And check that out. So if you expand air quickly, it's lower pressure. It also can create cooling. That's called adiabatic cooling. We see that a lot in the mountains when air is forced up. Okay, one other diagram here. Okay, so back to our original diagram. What are some of the effects of more dense air and less dense air? Well, one is if you were to boil water at sea level, you know, typically it's going to boil at about 212 degrees Fahrenheit, standardizing temperature and your altitude elevation. But if you were to go up, let's say at 10,000 feet in elevation, is it going to boil quicker or is it going to boil later? Well, we got to ask ourselves what's happening here. You're adding heat, you know, through, let's say, a propane stove, and then you have resistance. This water is going from one phase, liquid, to water vapor, a gas, and you're putting energy in there to do it, but the thing that's happening is the atmospheric pressure is giving it resistance. Okay, so in this case here, if there's more atmospheric pressure, let's say you're down at sea level, or maybe you have a pressure cooker, you know, it's going to boil probably at a higher temperature, right? Several degrees higher. And you can cook your broccoli a lot faster that way. If you're going to go up into the mountains, let's say 10,000 feet, it's going to boil quicker, and it's going to boil at a lower temperature. Why? Because there's less atmospheric pressure to resist it going from one phase, that is liquid, to water vapor. Okay, and so often if you read the directions on pasta packages, it'll say, hey, you know, if you're at higher elevations that you have to cook your pasta longer, and that's because the temperature is lower. Okay, and we know that folks who go like to 20,000 feet, Mount Denali, you know, they really, the water isn't even very hot when it starts to boil because there's so little atmospheric pressure as they go up. Now the other consequences that we have, and this is kind of fun, is with small airplanes, as pilots we have to know what's the air density. And we have, you know, the main thing is, of course, our elevation, okay, or our altitude if we're in the air. So over at sea level, you know, piece of cake, maybe we take off in 1,000, 1,300 feet, and the plane takes off fairly quickly. Maybe we even have, you know, some heavy adults in there. We have to be very careful with our weight, piece of cake. 10,000 feet, different story. The airplane, for starters, has to go much further. Look at how thin the air is. Okay, and it's not going to have as much power for the engine, less oxygen. Okay, so the engine isn't as strong, and you definitely are taking your chances. You're going to have a longer takeoff, and it's going to be much less responsive in that thin air. Okay, so again, we can tell that the air has mass, so we're rolling along. There we go, and we take off.